Hello and welcome to Streamers and Punches, the podcast from Sound Ocean TV that looks at current events and new releases in the world of film music. My name is Bill Witham.
And I'm Kevin Wilt.
And on today's show, we're going to look at a little bit in the way of headlines, a couple other announcements for CD releases, and talk about a few of the things that Kevin and I have been listening to this week. First up, there is a new premiere for composer Howard Shore. Kevin, you were reading about this. What happened?
Yeah, it looks like Howard Shore has composed a new cello concerto called Mythic Gardens. It's going to be premiered at the end of this month on April 27th and 28th by the American Symphony Orchestra under conductor Leon Botstein. Which is pretty cool. I don't know about you, Bill. Aside from the Lord of the Rings symphony things, I don't know of many or any Howard Shore concert pieces. So I think it's kind of cool that he has written a cello concerto. I'll be interested to hear what it will sound like. So,
yeah, you know, if I had more time, I'd create like a sound of a solo cello playing some themes for Lord of the Rings, and very snarkily say, "This is probably what it'll
say." That's like. What it's going to be.
No, yeah. Probably not. Hopefully not. That's just me being a smartass. I wish all the best for the premiere and the cello soloist and everything else. That sounds pretty cool.
Yeah. So if you're in and around New York and happen to be near Bard College at the end of the month, go see it and then tell us how it was, because I'm kind of interested to hear about it.
Yeah. Good program. Looks like it's got Ludoslavski, Brubeck. Nice. That is Christopher Brubeck, not Dave. And then Howard Shore and Bartok's Concerto for Orchestra. Fantastic piece.
Probably
of music.
Like the two best concertos for orchestra that you're going to find, both in the same concert. It's kind of nice.
Yeah, pretty good program overall. So, yeah, check that out if you're in the area, and write to us and let us know how it was. All right. Yeah. Next up, every couple weeks, you know, I like to talk about a few of the CDs that are coming out. I always mention a few websites, whether it's buysoundtracks.com or intrada.com. My favorite, which is Screen Archives. They're not plugging, you know, I mean, I'm plugging them, but they're not paying me. I just have ordered lots of things from them in the past, and they've been pretty swell. So there's a few new that I wanted to mention, a couple big hitters, and they may be sold out depending on, I guess, supplies. But Hook, John Williams' Hook from 1991, the sort of overblown Steven Spielberg movie, but it does kind of have a special place in my heart, even if the movie... I don't know if it quite holds up after 20 years.
The movie or the score?
No, the score is still fun. But I think the movie's a little bit, you know, there's Robin Williams in his cell phone, but it's before everyone else had cell phones, so it's really big and blocky. And he carries it like a gun, and he has that scene where he, like, draws it faster than the other guy. And it's so scenes like that don't really work very well.
At some point, you realize you're watching Robin Williams playing Peter Pan, and you don't want to really watch it after that. I mean, that's kind of all you need to know.
Well, it's kind of like you realize it's just Robin Williams, just basically being Robin Williams, but in green tights.
Right. Yeah, more or less.
And all the kids, for some reason, are just yelling Rufio all the time.
Right.
So, anyway.
Remember, you're playing someone who's really an overgrown child, so have a lot of energy and talk fast. Oh.
And that definitely happens. I just remember when this was announced and they're like, Julia Roberts is going to be Tinkerbell. And it's like, well, don't we want to actually see that it's Julia Roberts in the movie? And right. That Dustin Hoffman would be Captain Hook. He's actually one of my favorite things about the movie. So, and I love the score. So it's a lot of fun. And it's been a long time coming that even like I mentioned before, Star Trek VI, The Undiscovered Country, another favorite movie of mine from 1991, just had a 2-CD expansion release a few weeks ago, also available at the Screen Archives website. And just it's sort of great to sort of relive the memories of the scores and the fun movies from that year.
I have gotten mine in the mail today, Bill. I know you haven't received yours yet, but I know you're jealous because I got my copy early. I haven't listened to it yet because I just grabbed it out of the mailbox on the way in. But
yeah, well,
I'm excited.
Let me raise you one Hook to a Predator, which is the next thing I was going to say.
Whatever.
Let me get that centered.
There you go.
So anyway, Yeah, Predator is another one I want to announce. It just came out again for like the fourth time, and every time it gets re-released, there's like about two or 3,000 pressings, and then they sell out in a day, and everybody then sells it for, oh, I don't know, $50, $60, $75 on eBay. It's criminal. So anyway, if you like Predator, the score by Alan Silvestri from 87, pick it up. Again, it's at that website. Screenarchives.com is a great location for it. Some of the others would have it as well. And it's got that little Elliot Goldenthal version of the 20th Century Fox fanfare at the beginning of it, which is actually, I believe he used it in his score to Alien 3. So he sort of transformed the fanfare. But then for some reason, just because I guess they think of aliens and predators as in the same category, so they put that fanfare on this soundtrack to make it kind of a nice...
there have been some things popping up around the internet the past, well, maybe 4 or 5 weeks about Brian Tyler rewriting the Universal fanfare logo for the 100th anniversary, I think it is. And so you can see there have been some like little video clips of the recording session and something and things like that. So you can kind of get a sense for what Brian Tyler has done with the Universal logo theme music. I don't remember which film is going to be the first one to carry it, but I'm sure that'll be something we talk about when it kind of comes around as well.
Well, yeah, have you listened to the actual fanfare, the new one?
I haven't listened to the whole thing. I only just caught the few moments of it when I was watching like this little behind the scenes video type of thing.
Okay. I did actually see it. We should definitely feature it in our next episode because it's a very short clip of music, but it's kind of interesting to talk about what changes he made to it. I mean, from a composer standpoint, what maybe unfairly I think of as just unnecessary changes that he did to it. But I don't know which movie it's going to go in front of either. But it looks fantastic. I mean, the graphics they've got for the Universal, the Earth, the way it spins out, and the logo, that's pretty amazing. But the music is there too. The music sounds really good, but there's a few things there compositionally that I sort of raised an eyebrow. But then again, I mean, I'm partial to Jerry Goldsmith because he's a favorite of mine. So anyway, okay. So I'm getting stalled out here. Let me run through the list. So here's a few that I sort of picked out. It's like Bill's picks of CDs that would be worth picking up. So if you can still get Hook in a 2-CD version, get it. If you can get Predator, get that definitely. There's a 5-CD version of Ben-Hur that Lucas Kendall and his guys over at Film Score Monthly helped remaster and expand. So if you're into Ben-Hur, which is by Miklos Rosa, pick that up. It's a fantastic biblical epic. It doesn't get more grand Hollywood style than that. It's Alive is a horror movie by Bernard Herrmann. And let's see, there's actually, it's also available through Film Score Monthly's production. You know, they helped create the CD, and they've got these really great clips, so you can hear the Bernard Herrmann music from various moments in the score. The Black Cauldron is an 80s and a Disney animated sort of sword and sorcery movie with a score by Elmer Bernstein. White Fang is I think I might have mentioned this in a previous episode, but it's basically the Basil Polidori score plus the Hans Zimmer somewhat rejected but somewhat included in the film score put together, so you have a 2-CD representation there, and that's it. So all those can be picked up at Screen Archives and some of the other various websites like buysoundtracks.com and most definitely eBay. So check some of those out. Those are well worth it, and I'll stay on the lookout for anything else that that looks cool coming out. And of course, if you remember when Daniel Schweiger was on our show, I think it was a link of his on Facebook that had the Universal thing when I saw it. So we'll come back to that in a future episode. I don't know, Kevin, maybe we can put together some of the old fanfares in succession and have a chance to compare them side by side. It might be a nice little montage.
Go nuts.
But also Dan Schweiger mentioned that this next year of 2012 would be like the year of everything else that hasn't been released or expanded to be coming out. So kind of exciting. I know Hook was definitely on that list and now it's out. Star Trek VI was on that list for me anyway, and it's out. So I'm looking forward to, let's see, now Gremlins is out. Maybe there's a couple other Goldsmiths that haven't been released, but anyway, we'll see. So pretty cool. Now, so Kevin, what interesting things have you been listening to this week?
Well, I've been running to a couple of different things. This weekend, of course, saw the premiere of Wrath of the Titans. And so I checked out a little bit of that score by Javier Navarrete. You know, I can't say a lot about it. I haven't seen the film, and I haven't listened to the entire score. But I think it really goes hand in hand with the film. You know, you see the trailers for the film, and you pretty much know what it's probably going to be. It's going to have some scenes of Liam Neeson wearing his Zeus beard, saying things sounding like Liam Neeson, and then there are going to be a bunch of giant CG creatures that try and kill people, and that's probably most of the movie. And the little bit that I have heard of this score has that same kind of predictability to it. It's, you know, it has a lot of that sort of, you know, because it's set in ancient Greece, it has a lot of that kind of tribal ethnic percussion that we associate with anything that is old and or foreign, regardless of what foreign place it comes from.
Right.
So it's a lot of that kind of ethnic percussion kind of thing with...
They all sound like the Middle Eastern set of sample sounds that you are...
Yeah, exactly. It comes from that sample library. Exactly.
For $500.
Yeah. So, like I said, you know, I don't want to slam the... Because I haven't seen the film and I haven't listened to the whole score, but I heard enough of the score to realize I didn't want to listen to the rest of the score.
Was there any one thing now if you recall, I don't know if you've seen Pan's Labyrinth, but I remember seeing it and thinking that the score had something kind of nice. It had, you know, I think there was some flute solos and just a little bit of attention to some color and actually semi-decent to mostly decent orchestral writing, but I don't remember anything more, which of course might just be me kind of implying that it was unmemorable, but I remember thinking there was potential there with that composer. And was there anything at all that seemed
not really. I think because this was such a big budget, big release kind of thing, that the score had a very I don't want to exactly say it was generic, because that is maybe a little bit too harsh, but it had that kind of a sound that, because it's such a big blockbuster movie, they could have brought in any of a dozen composers and had them write that same score.
Okay.
You know, because it was such a big blockbuster thing, they wanted it to be as accessible and audience friendly and kind of hip sounding as possible. So it seems like it's very stylistically constrained. That whoever they hired was basically, that was the same score that they would have kind of been forced to push out, you know?
Right. I'm just checking to confirm the composer on the first one, because I did see that one with my fingers crossed, hoping that the movie would be fun and a fun remake. Because that's like when you go in any movie now, it's like, I hope this is a fun remake, because they're all remakes. Ramin Djawadi, who I believe did the original Iron Man. Okay, I'm at IMDb, so I'll just check to make sure.
He did the first season of Game of Thrones too, right?
Yeah, and you know, that main title for Game of Thrones, it's like, it's got that cool sort of solo viola sound, like Lord of the Rings, you know, the like the, well, not viola, but the Hardinger fiddle that Howard Shore used for the horse people, Aedoras, right? Rohan, thank you.
Yes, you're welcome.
But
my third film saves the day.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So Ramin Djawadi. Iron Man, and then of course the first Clash of the Titans. Boy, it was really generic. And then when I heard Game of Thrones, I was like, wow, it's just sort of like, it's just this big sound that would just do nothing if it was written for the piano. Yeah. And then, of course, through orchestration. So I was hoping that maybe the movie would have... Well, there's no sequel to Clash of the Titans originally. And so I was hoping that with the sequel, the movie itself might free itself up and have a little more fun. And I'd read a review that sounded like it might have been doing that. But what's up with all these summer movies, like Hunger Games and then now this? And it's just weird. I don't know. Like, they just totally want to run for the hills because Avengers is going to come out in another month. So,
I don't know. Maybe it does seem a little early for all these summer movies. You're right.
Yeah, maybe they should, because Revengers is gonna make a mess.
Well, that and Dark Knight Rises, absolutely.
Oh yeah. Well, and Spider-Man's gonna make a few dollars too. So.
The other thing I've been listening to this week, I've been listening to a little bit of David Arnold and Michael Price's music to the second season of the BBC's Sherlock. Now, this is a soundtrack that doesn't come out in the U.S. until May. But the second season of TV and the soundtrack has been out in the UK for quite a while now. So needless to say, it is, if you look, you know, not even that hard. If you spend 20 seconds to look for this music on the internet, you can find it. It's interesting. It's very much in the same vein as the season one music, but it's just fun, I guess. I don't know. It works really well for the character. It has a lot of that kind of cheeky humor that you find in that particular series, and it's cool stuff. It's nice hearing, you know, David Arnold, who of course has scored all sorts of different movies, the James Bond movies, and all sorts of different things. It's kind of cool to see a composer of that caliber working on a TV show, which, aside from, you know, maybe Bear McCreary or Michael Giacchino, you don't see too many composers of that level also working on TV shows. So,
right. Is there kind of a harpsichord thing going on in his scores?
There is a little bit of that. It's interesting when you compare the David Arnold and Michael Price Sherlock music to the Hans Zimmer Sherlock Holmes music. They both scores have a kind of like a folky ethnic kind of a sound, whether it's like an out-of-tune harpsichord or just a tinny piano with like some fiddling kinds of things. Both scores tend to have that. I think that's a little bit less so in the BBC Sherlock music. And then of course Hans Zimmer amps that kind of thing up in the second Sherlock Holmes movie, with not only does he have the tinny piano and the fiddle, but he's got the whole band of gypsy musicians that he was using as well. So I think the second season of Sherlock and the second Sherlock Holmes film, the scores are more separate than the first season and the first film were, because those seem to have a lot of things in common. So
okay,
it'll be interesting to hear the whole thing when that show airs in the U.S. Next month, I guess.
Yeah, it's coming in May. I just think it's kind of interesting that with Sherlock Holmes, that the go-to instrument is either a harpsichord or piano or some kind of keyboard in order to sound cerebral, I suppose. That's the connection
I'm talking. I think you hear a lot of solo violin stuff too, because of course the character sits there and plays violin, so it would make sense for his theme to often be violin. One of the tracks from this series 2 soundtrack, just from judging from the titles, I suppose, the character of Irene Adler is introduced in the second season, who is of course the Holmes love interest, but her theme on the soundtrack is played by solo violin, so it's obviously very much supposed to be kind of the perspective of, it's Sherlock's perspective on her, which seems of course very appropriate.
Right, and that's a mighty fine episode, that first one that features Irene Adler. They're all enjoyable, but that one's particularly fun and clever and humorous and everything else. So anyway, Sherlock, definitely check it out. Great score and very fun, colorful, and it goes to a fantastic television show. Mm-hmm. I can't say enough good things about it. BBC just, they know what they're doing. So, congrats, BBC. Absolutely. This week was kind of my, I guess, unintentional James Newton Howard week. I didn't start off thinking that that's what it needed to be, but I watched the film Water for Elephants, and I had heard the score before through Spotify, and I was able to listen to that, and then I was able to watch the film, and it does it's a nice score. I mean, it reminds me of James Newton Howard from the 90s in a way that doesn't sound, I'm trying to not have that sound like, oh, it's antiquated James Newton Howard, and I'm old-fashioned, and I don't want any of his new sound to you know, creep in. It's like, I don't really think of it that way. It's just more like it's got great melodic writing and sort of that James Newton Howard sound. Is there, and maybe because of the sort of timeless circus, old-fashioned element of the film, it doesn't really justify a lot of use of loops, thank God, because you actually get the sound of what he would write like to score a scene, and you are allowed to hear that in several spots. So it's very nice. I also listened to The Hunger Games. Again, this was actually, I have not seen the movie. I'm kind of not really interested in seeing the movie. That's just me. I'm not a fan of the books. But he did compose the score. And Kevin, wasn't this originally Danny Elfman? Going to be Danny Elfman?
It was supposed to be Danny Elfman, but James Newton Howard came in. I mean, at this point, I think it was probably about like a year ago. It was pretty early on in the process that he replaced Danny Elfman. And I think it had to do... It either had to do with Danny Elfman's Cirque du Soleil thing or this new Dark Shadows Tim Burton movie that he's scoring.
Oh,
I think it was some sort of schedule conflict, but that was, I think, quite a while back that they announced that.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I mean, I had to see the movie to see how it works in the film, but just as sort of a set of ideas, it makes me glad that I listened to Water for Elephants, I guess, because it tends to kind of graze, which is actually a word that James Newton Howard came up with that he and Hans Zimmer talked about, that they didn't want their music to graze when they worked on Batman Begins or The Dark Knight, where the music can score the scene, but otherwise it just kind of sits there and it doesn't do much more. From what they selected for the soundtrack, a lot of it tends to be very kind of generic, and here's a musical phrase, and when it gets to the end of a phrase, you have a suspension that resolves. That sound is just trademark Hollywood at this point.
Yeah.
And it's been used in everything from Harry Gregson Williams' score to the Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe to, well, several things by John Powell. And
Have we had a show about that particular musical feature? I don't remember if we've done a show about that phenomenon or not.
Just the suspension that comes at the end of the phrase?
That whole particular chord progression that seems to show up.
Okay, that's not. I'm not actually referring to the minor chord progression that turns major and sounds like a heroic struggle.
Yeah.
That ends triumphantly. We could, although Film Score Monthly did a pretty good show dissecting that and showing many of the scores.
Early on, we had a show about that, but now I can't remember.
No, we didn't do. I avoided that one just because they touched on it pretty well.
Yeah. Okay.
But anyway, so I'm just talking about just getting to the end of a phrase and you have a suspension is sort of it's real old hat at this point. There's a Horns of Plenty is one of the tracks on there that's probably the most liveliest and the most brassy. And I'm not going to try to like, oh, I bet it's for this one part in the movie because I don't really care. But I'm just listening
right.
to it. And I notice just musically, it just kind of reminds me of the original score to Clash of the Titans. But maybe not as cool. I don't know. But anyway, I don't want to rail on it too much. I just kind of thought, you know, he was brought in and it was probably like, please just score this movie. We don't need to ask too much more of you than that. And we've got some songs that are going to be in the movie. So just kind of stay out of the way. And it's a blockbuster. So don't screw this up for us. That's sort of what I thought after listening to it. I couldn't really say that's a strong recommendation, but if you like something that's nice and dramatic with good line and it's something that sounds good, I would recommend Water for Elephants. So that's what I've been listening to. Yeah. I think check out a future episode. We'll do something with the Universal thing. I think definitely that's on the plate for next time. Fun. Yeah.
And okay. I'm sure next time we'll spend probably at least a little bit of time talking about listening to the Hook 2 CD set that because you haven't gotten yours yet and I just got mine today, so
yeah, we got to make sure we listen to it at the exact same time so we can then discuss it afterwards and just completely nerd out in synchronous order. Okay,
isn't that what we essentially do on Monday nights when we record this show anyway?
Oh yeah,
we just sit here and nerd out about film music stuff.
I think so.
Lord of the Rings.
I think
also
so.
Also, we talked to Lord of the Rings a little bit today. That's true.
And sometimes Star Trek, and sometimes Doctor Who.
Yeah, we do allow this show to rise to a fairly nerdy level quite frequently, but that should come as no surprise.
So, all right. Well, speaking of nerdy levels, that'll do it for this week. We're going to go out with a little bit of the BBC Sherlock series 2. Is this a little bit of the theme, Kevin, by David Arnold?
I think we do get it's a part of a cue, but I think we get a little bit of the opening main title theme, which is not exactly the same. You know, there's the Sherlock theme that shows up as part of the underscore, but the actual main opening title theme music is slightly different. And we get a little bit of that in this particular cue. So,
All right. So check that out, because we're going to play it in just a moment. What I'm trying to say. All right. So that will do it for this episode of Streamers and Punches. You can listen to us on soundnotion.tv/SAP, where you can also subscribe to our show, leave comments, and find links to the music we spoke about. You can also subscribe to the show through iTunes. My name is Bill Witham.
And I'm Kevin Wilt.
Thank you for listening, and we'll see you next week. Thank you.